Morning, everyone. I see there's still a few strolling in from the parking lot, so it's good to be here the first Sunday of this year. Good to see so many of you after a little bit of snow last night, and it's good to see that you were able to get out. We welcome you to the house of the Lord, and we come here to worship Him. And let's do that and start by singing Glory to God. Comes from Psalm 84. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may have her young, a place near your altar. Lord Almighty, my King and my God, blessed are those who dwell in the house. They are ever praising you. Let's turn to the Lord in a moment of silent prayer, and after which we'll sing, He is Lord. Thank you, God, that you are that you welcome us into your presence. We thank you that you are God above us, God beside us, and God with us, and God within us. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Let's sing Everlasting God. may be seated. Our call to confession comes from Romans chapter 3 and chapter 7. Romans 3, 9 to 12. What shall we conclude then? Do we have any advantage? Not at all. For we have already made the charge that Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the power of sin. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. And in Romans 7, verse 14, we know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do. This I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. And in Romans 7, verse 24 to 25, we have the assurance of pardon. What a wretched man am I! Who will rescue me from his body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God, who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, I myself in my mind am a slave to God's law, but in my sinful nature, a slave to the law of sin. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And that is our assurance that God is there to rescue us from our sin. Let's turn to a song, Jesus, All for Jesus.
Thank you.
to do a reflection and an anticipation for last year and for the year to come, seeing this is the new year. And also, the children, there's no children's school today, church school, so you're allowed to stay up here, or if your parents want to take you somewhere, they may do so, but it's nice that you can be with us for a Sunday and join us.
Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, at the beginning of this brand new year, we are gathered here in your house to praise you for your greatness, your complete control over our lives, and the entire universe. We are sinful, broken, and selfish, but you are merciful, gracious, and loving, and promise to go with us into this new year. We begin by reflecting on this past year with the thanksgiving for new life you have given to our congregation. Caitlin, Lily, Anna, and Hannah were all born into this church family in 2016. We thank you for these baby girls, as well as all the grandchildren, nieces, and nephews that were born or adopted into our families this year.
We praise you for the joy these children have already brought their families. Please continue to bless them with safety and health in the new year. We also pray for expecting mothers in 2017. Lord, we thank you for the promise of new life. Please grant healthy pregnancies, we pray.
We also mourn with those that have lost loved ones this past year. In our immediate church family, we pray for the family and loved ones of Nell Belkman, Ann Walters, and Tom McKay, as well as many other members of this church who have lost mothers, fathers, and other special people in their lives.
Grant your peace and nearness, we pray this year, as special anniversaries, birthdays, Mother's Day, and Father's Day go by with no one to celebrate with. Please be with all our members who grieve lost loved ones, whether recently or from years ago, for whatever reason, accidents, physical or mental sickness. Lord, please grant healing.
Lord, be with those that are continuing to suffer in our church, whether through age, illness, accidents, or struggling with mental illness.
Lord, show our church family how to lovingly accept, support, and walk alongside each other through our challenges.
As a congregation, we are currently without a pastor. We have had opportunity to question who we are and what direction we are going as a church, to examine our strengths, admit our weaknesses, and to appreciate each other's gifts, and to understand our complete reliance on the Holy Spirit. We thank you for the work Pastor Harold has done in the years he was in Fredericton, and ask that you continue to bless his work in Ontario to promote your kingdom.
We ask a special measure of your insight for the council this year as they lead this church without a pastor. Thank you for leading us to Reverend Neil and Ruth Jaspers. We ask that all preparations will go smoothly and that they can soon be a part of our church for a time.
We thank you for the opportunities to celebrate this year, for the marriage of Ryan and Julia Vrugenhill. By your grace, they have overcome obstacles, and we praise you for this testimony of faith they have been for you, and ask for your continued blessing on this family. We are also thankful for Austin Versloot's profession of faith this year, for the Holy Spirit's presence in his life, and the other young people in our church. We are especially thankful for the week of serve that five youth and a leader could experience this summer.
We pray for a blessing on all the programs of this church, for the gyms, youth, Sunday school, BBS, and small group Bible studies. For those that work at Bibles for Missions and in our local schools, may we hear our calling to serve you in these programs that we can be a light in our communities.
In closing, you have left us with two commandments, to love God and to love our neighbor, regardless of our age, ability, vocation, you have given us all the same two commandments, and you have also promised to equip us.
May 2017 be for all of us a year of continued spiritual growth, always closer to you. Secondly, may we see each interaction we have with another person as an opportunity to show your love. Amen.
Our offerings today will be the General Fund and World Renew. I don't know if anybody was asked to read, but Krista was supposed to read, so if not.
We can have a word of prayer, please. Our Father, who art in heaven, we ask you to be with us during this coming year. Lord, we ask you to open your word to us, to help us to understand what you are trying to tell us, and to know that you are there for us always. Lord, we ask you, as Jerry gives the sermon, to help us understand it, as we ask in Jesus' name. We can turn to page 880 in our pew Bibles, and it's John 19, verses 25 to 27. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From this time on, this disciple took her into his home. Thank you.
Our sermon today was prepared by Peter Janssens, and it's entitled Family Matters. So I don't know if that's Family Matters or if it's Family Matters. It could be taken two ways. Today is the first Sunday of the new year. Traditionally, the beginning of a new year is when people tend to make New Year's resolutions. So if you Google the top 10 New Year's resolutions, this was 2 years ago, you'll find lose weight, read more books, go traveling, spend less time on the internet, do something for charity, quit smoking or drinking, socialize more in real life and not social networking, throw away unwanted stuff in the clothes closet, save money, learn a new hobby. That's a great list. But what is interesting is that if you Google also the top 10 broken New Year's resolutions, this is what you'll find. Drink less. Get a better education. Get a better job. Get fit. Lose weight. Manage debt. Manage stress. Quit smoking. Save money. Take a vacation. And volunteer. Now, if you compare these two lists, it's pretty obvious that there is quite a bit of an overlap, which means that somewhere there is a breakdown between the people we want to be and the people we are. And the breakdown is most likely around this one word, sacrifice. Neil Plantinga defines sacrifice as giving up something of value in order to gain something of a greater value. So, for example, when it comes to our New Year's resolutions, if the greater value that I'm shooting for is to be slimmer, more physically fit, a version of myself, then it means I need to sacrifice certain kinds of food as well as time on the couch, and I need to eat healthy food as well as go jogging or swimming or some other exercise. Or if my greater value is to have a financial situation where I have no debt, it is going to mean I need to sacrifice certain bad money management habits and learn how to budget my finances. That's how it works. But that is not how we want it to work. We would rather get to where we want to be without all that sacrifice. So what happens is we start with good intentions. But then the sacrifices start to hurt, and we don't like it. And before you know it, we're starting to cut corners. And eventually, we're right back where we started. In other words, when we renege on our resolutions, what we're saying is, I think that there is a better version of me out there, and I know that I can live a great life of greater value than I'm living now, but getting there is too much like work. So I'm going to just stay in the life I'm living now. I'll settle for what I have. Now, the unfortunate thing is that sometimes this attitude creeps into the church as well, in that Jesus comes to us and promises us life, and not only that, but life to the full. But in order to get that, it involves some sacrifice. It involves taking up the cross, denying ourselves, and then following Him. And the truth is, this gets really hard for people. And the sad reality is that far too many people who call themselves Christians end up settling for something less than what Jesus promised. Now, when you look at the life of Mary, the mother of Jesus, if there is one thing you can learn about this remarkable woman, is that she was a woman who was willing to make sacrifices. In other words, she was a woman who was willing to give up something of value in order to gain something of a greater value. So to illustrate that point, let's look together at John 19, 25, 27. We'll read it again. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother, his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciples whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. So here's the scene. Mary is gathered with a small group of friends, and they're standing by the cross where Mary's son Jesus is hung. This scene would be excruciating for any parent, except Mary wasn't just any parent. She happened to be the mother of the Son of God. Let's just briefly go back over Mary's story. Just 33 years ago, Mary had an encounter with an angel, and the angel told her that she was going to have a baby and that this baby was going to be the Son of God. Now, as wonderful as this news sounded, it didn't come without sacrifice. Because in order to be the mother of the Messiah, Mary had to give up something of value, namely her honor and her dignity, because it meant going through life as an unwed mother of Jesus. Then shortly after Jesus was born, Mary and Joseph brought Jesus to the temple in Jerusalem for the ritual of purification, circumcision, and dedication. And while they were there, they met up with an old man named Simeon. And Simeon celebrates the fact that the Messiah has arrived. But then his celebration turns somber as he says these words, "This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." This is what we read in Luke 2:34-35. So what Simeon was saying is that when Jesus grows up, he's not going to be the Messiah that everybody is expecting. As a matter of fact, following Jesus is going to require sacrifice because it's going to go against the popular view of what most people think a Messiah should do. Because most people think that the Messiah came to save them from their circumstances. But this Messiah came to save people from their sins. And then he adds, "And Mary, you're going to have to decide as well which one he is." And Mary did struggle. As a matter of fact, there is a scene where Jesus is in a house and the crowds are pressing in on Jesus. And while they're there pressing in on the inside, we are told that outside of the house, when his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him. They said, "He is out of his mind." And things get intense. And we read, "Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived, standing outside. They sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, 'Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you.'" That's what we read in Mark 3. And Jesus responds, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, "Here is my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother." Now we do not know exactly how Mary got to this point of thinking that Jesus was out of his mind, and we don't know what kind of a struggle she went through. What we do know is that somewhere in the journey, Mary decided to follow Jesus on his terms, and that she needed him for her life. So when everyone else decided to bail on Jesus, Mary stayed close by and followed him all the way to the cross, along with a few close friends. And I'm sure that as she stood there and watched him die, that sword that Simeon spoke about 33 years ago must have pierced her soul like nothing else. And I'm sure that this must have been the worst kind of sacrifice for a parent to endure. I mean, how can you possibly imagine giving up anything of greater value than a child? And so Mary stood at the foot of the cross with a couple of close friends and watched her tortured son slowly die an excruciating death. And John tells us in chapter 19 and following that when Jesus saw his mother there, and remember what Jesus said earlier about who is his mother, but the person who does the will of his Father, and the disciples who he loved standing nearby her, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Now there is so much more going on here. But one of the things we need to understand is that when Jesus addresses his mother as woman, he is in no way speaking disrespectful of her. You see, the Greek word that we read as woman is the word gune, and it literally means the bride, the becoming one, the lovely one, the darling one, beautiful one. In other words, it is a word of honor. And I'm sure Jesus uses this word for Mary intentionally, because as a woman who carried the stigma of a dishonorable woman, Jesus needed to remind her of who she really was in the eyes of God. So Jesus says, "Beautiful one." And then he presents his mother to the person known as the disciple whom he loved. Now scholars are in agreement that the disciple whom Jesus loved was John the Apostle. John's brother James, who was also a disciple, were the sons of Zebedee. Zebedee had a wife named Salome, who happened to be Mary's sister, who was also standing at the cross with Mary and John. So not only is the disciple whom Jesus loved by one of the disciples, he is also Jesus' cousin. Now the reason why Jesus was setting up this mother-son relationship between John and Mary is because God's law was very clear that widows needed to be looked after. You see, in those days, there was no welfare system. There was no food bank, no social housing. And so widows and orphans and crippled people and foreigners often were left to beg in some form or another just to make money. And if widows were overlooked in that society, then widows with a reputation were even worse off. And Mary did have a reputation. She would have been known as the mother of an illegitimate son named Jesus. And so Mary would have been treated in a very similar way that prostitutes would have been treated, which is why Jesus, in his love for Mary, makes sure she is looked after before he dies. Now, of course, the question arises that if Jesus had brothers and sisters, then why wouldn't they be looking after their mother? Why does Jesus entrust his mother to his cousin? That's a good question. And the answer comes when you look at who followed Jesus to the cross, or rather, when you look at who did not follow Jesus to the cross. And the ones who did not follow Jesus to the cross were his brothers and sisters. And do you remember what Jesus said about who his true mother and brothers were? He said, "Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother." You see, what Jesus is doing here, even as he is dying on the cross, he is redefining family. In other words, he is giving us a picture of what the covenant community ought to look like. And a covenant community who identify themselves as followers of Jesus are people who are willing to make sacrifices for others as Jesus sacrificed for us. That is a covenant community of people who would be willing to give up something of value in order to gain something of a greater value. And the greater value is seeing people treated with dignity and honor and respect. It is ensuring that others are provided for, that they have justice, and know that they are loved, not just by us, but by a God who is willing to give his life for us, which is what John does for Mary. And so the Bible tells us that from that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Now again, think of what this must have meant for John to be willing to take Mary into his home, especially giving her reputation. It would have meant that he would be throwing his own reputation under the bus. In other words, it meant that he would have to sacrifice his own honor to make sure that a woman who wasn't even his own mother would be cared for and looked after. And this is exactly what he did. Because somehow, John believed that sacrificing his reputation was nothing compared to knowing that the honor and provision and dignity of Mary was protected and looked after. Now you have to wonder if John had any idea that when he took Mary into his home in order to care for her as if she was his own mom, if he had any clue that this act of obedience to Jesus would start a movement that would transform the world. Here's what I mean. If you follow that story, you'll know that 3 days after Jesus died and was laid in the tomb, the earth shook and the temple shroud was torn in two, and Jesus walked out of the grave alive. And this single event would signify that everything was about to change, that a new day was dawning, something new was happening. And then 50 days after that, 10 days after Jesus ascended into heaven, the Holy Spirit was poured out, and God's love filled people like it had never filled them before. And people were so committed to each other in this new community of love that they were willing to make sacrifices for one another. in order that everyone felt included, and everyone was cared for, and everyone had what they needed, and everyone felt loved and honored. And the Bible describes that scene like this: selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. That's what it says in Acts. Now, this is radical stuff. And if you look closely through the New Testament, you'll find that the reason why they did this is because this is what the family of God does. This is what it means to be a covenant community. Paul said it like this in Timothy: treat older women as if they were your mothers. Treat younger women as if they were your sisters. Be completely pure in the way you treat them. John said it like this in John 3:16: we know what love is because Jesus Christ gave his life for us. So we should give our lives for our brothers and sisters. In other words, we sacrifice for others because Jesus sacrificed for us. You see, Jesus loved us so much that he was willing to sacrifice something of value, his life, in order to gain something of greater value, a relationship with you and me. In other words, Jesus loved us so much that he was willing to die for us rather than live without us. Which brings us to today. This is the first Sunday of a new year. As we look into this new year, the question we as church community need to ask ourselves is, what kind of a community do we want to be? As people who call ourselves follower of Jesus Christ, are we willing to sacrifice for others as he sacrificed for us? Can we welcome others into our homes as Jesus does for us and as John did for Mary? Do we want our homes to be places where relationships with others can grow and flourish, and where people can welcome, feel welcome, and that they belong? Do we see ourselves as a collection of families, or do we see ourselves as one? If we see ourselves as one family, then what sacrifices are we willing to make this happen? Mary sacrificed her dignity and honor for Jesus, and Jesus promised her a special place in the family of God. John followed Jesus and sacrificed his reputation in order that Mary could be treated with honor, and Jesus gave him a special place in the family of God. Later, the disciples followed Jesus, and they sacrificed money and time and their homes so that others would feel loved and accepted and provided for. And they gained special places in the family of God. So as we begin a new year, what do you hear God saying to you? What sacrifices is he calling you to make? As we think about this, the thing we need to keep in mind is that this one thing is certain. If we want to realize who we really are in Christ, and if we truly want to become the family of God, then we've got to be willing to sacrifice. Let's pray. Spirit of God, work in us so that we may be willing to sacrifice for the sake of the family of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll now rise and sing our hymn of response, "Help Us Accept Each Other." At this time, let's turn to our Lord in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you that we can come before you here today. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, who died for us. We thank you for the sacrifice that he made. And we pray, Lord, that you will be with us, that we will also be able to make sacrifices for you. We ask you, Lord, that you will be with us and with this church as we go into the new year, not knowing what is ahead, Lord, but trusting in you for all that happens. We ask you, Lord, that you will be with some of the people that are healing in the church, Lord, whether it's mentally or physically. We ask you, Lord, that you will be with them all, that you will watch over them, help them heal, and bring them back to their feet so that they can go about doing what they want to do, Lord. We pray that you will be with them and give them the strength. We also pray, Lord, that you'll be with the mothers that are expecting. We ask you, Lord, that you'll be with them. Sometimes this can be a stressful time for mothers and also grandmothers. We ask you that you'll be with them and that you'll watch over them and that everything may go well and that the babies may grow up to be strong and be born as healthy children. We ask you, Lord, that you'll be with this church as we go on into the new year. We ask that you'll be with the people that do the programs in the church, the Bible studies, coffee break, GEMS, and other programs, praise team. We ask you, Lord, that you'll be with them as they go into the new year, that you will guide them and that they may do all this for your glory. We ask you, Lord, that you will be with the people in the world also, Lord. There are so many that do not know you, and there are so many out there, even in our own neighborhoods, that don't know you. We live right beside them, Lord, and we ask you that you will help us to make our sacrifices for you so that we can also bring them to your house, that they may come here and also know you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our doxology will be, Father, we love you. and awesome God. May we be kept and upheld in your faithfulness each day of this week. May we know your authority, Heavenly Father. May we be kept in your love, Lord Jesus. And may we be comforted by your power, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.